Welcome aboard the ADOTAT Show, where marketing, media, and adtech converge. Fasten your seatbelts as your host, Hisat Latin, steers you through the digital world of advertising trends and marketing innovation.
Deserve to win when it matters most. Facing multi-billion dollar bet the company litigation. No problem. That's why we're here. Troutman Amin, LLP, is a true legal powerhouse.
All right, everyone, let's get ready for a roller coaster ride of wit and wisdom on the ADOTAT Show. We're about to introduce some of the brightest minds in the ad tech world, each a master in blending digital innovation with environmental consciousness. Let's meet our panel of EcoSavvy trailblazers. First, we have Andy Batkin, the digital dymo, CEO of Duration Media, and the man who saw tomorrow's internet today. He's the brains behind turning Yahoo into more than a catchy name. Andy is the guy who's been making waves in the digital seas long before most of us knew how to surf the web. He's here to show us how green can be the new gold in the digital realm. Next, we welcome our returning champion, Shiv Gupta, the guru of the digital domain. He's not just teaching the future of digital marketing, he's writing it. With a track record that turns heads and open minds, Shiv brings the kind of insight into the table that turns complex tech talk into digital enlightenment. He's the Yoda of adtech, and he's here to school us all. Step aside, Eco Warriors, and make way for David Murnick, the North American GM and Global Partnership Wizard at 551 to Carbon Zero, broadcasting his green genius straight from the heart of New York City. David is the go-to girl for companies looking to paint their carbon footprints in green. Next is Ben Skinazi, the maestro of programmatic advertising. As the CMO at ShareThrough, he's painting the digital world in shades of sustainable green. With over a decade in the digital media galaxy, Ben is the guy turning clicks into eco-friendly currency. Watch out, he might just make you a believer in green pixels. Give it up for Jean-Marc Papin, the data virtuoso steering the ship at Horizon Media. Jean-Marc does not just work with data, he makes it a dance. He's on a quest to morph the ad universe into an eco-friendly oasis, one smart data point at a time. Last but definitely not least is the one and only Brian O'Kelly, the titan of tech. If ad tech had a hall of fame, Brian's bust would be in the entrance of it. The mastermind behind Scope 3, he's turning the ad world green, one carbon footprint at a time. He's not just talking about a sustainable future, he's building it. Ladies and gentlemen, that's our lineup for today's ADOTAT Roundtable. Prepare for a deep dive into the world where cutting-edge technology meets masterful environmental mindness. First of all, issue number one, Brian. It's estimated the internet contributes to about 2 to 3% of global greenhouse emissions. How big is that?
Global greenhouse emissions, 50 gigatons a year. If you break that down, about 20% of that is energy use. The vast majority of energy use goes to things like industrial production and heating houses. If you look at the internet or tech in general, it's about 2 to 4% of the overall footprint. And I think there's a recent report by Microsoft that said that AI is now using 1% of the world's electricity on its own. And Microsoft is considering building nuclear reactors to keep up with the growth of AI. And so if you consider that so much of this digital technology is funded by advertising, I think it's reasonable to say that advertising has direct or indirect responsibility for some small portion of the world's emissions, certainly not like agriculture or global air transit, but certainly tens of millions of metric tons. And I think the most interesting point is we can reduce that significantly, very quickly, without harming anyone. There's a ton of waste that we can go address.
So maybe I would add something here to Brian. And I think this is extremely interesting to say how much we are producing, how much processing we need to power everything we process every day, right? AI. We will talk at some point about Web3 and Metaverse, which is also extremely high demanding in carbon. And I think there is, and maybe I will open a debate here, which is not my intention, but there are like two factors which generate carbon dioxide, right? We have like the use of electricity, but also building the servers. actually building the servers, which are which are behind everything, is way higher. I mean, it's substantially higher than building the electricity consumption, right? So there is a whole supply chain which happened, like physical supply chain, to build that infrastructure which makes this possible. So it's really interesting how that kind of a changing of the realities, right, between a physical supply chain, which maybe in the past was more like roads, trucks, and let's say warehouses, right, to a more digital supply chain, which is like server, cables, and everything which is around it. So I think that's more technical view of it. But it's interesting to see how the world is also evolving in that direction. And yeah, probably that's also a way to address the problem here.
Shiv, I'm curious, outside of the eco-warriors here, for lack of a better term, how is the industry viewing this? Are they considering this as actually a badge of honor?
You know, my perception is that a lot of folks right now are they're thinking and they're talking about it as a almost like a, hey, we got to do this from a PR perspective. We got to do this because it aligns to the, you know, the pillars of the company that they've publicly announced. I don't think people have quite recognized the performance kind of aspect of it, the actual, like, the dollars align with the cause aspect of it. I think that's most folks, like, on the ground. And so I think there still needs to be a lot of, like, education and, you know, people need to understand that it's not just about checking a box, right? Like, my sense is still people feel that it's a box checking exercise. So that's something that we as an industry have to work on, because it's not, right? And I think, again, everyone's going to keep going back to Brian on this, but, like, I think Brian speaks to it really articulately of, like, hey, it's more than that. It's bigger than that. It's actually, like, the dollars aligned to the cause. So I think there's work to be done.
Andy mentioned before we started that at CES, besides AI, it was sustainability was the number two topic that everyone was talking about. Was it in regards to the ad industry or in general tech, Andy?
I think the brands are really, you know, driving this. I mean, look, you know, our focus is digital media, and, you know, being at the Cosmopolitan Aria, that's, you know, we sort of taken over those two hotels. So the conversation is really focused on digital, and digital media. And really the brands are driving this. They're going to their agencies and saying, we really need to start reducing our carbon footprint in digital, among others, right? You know, as I mentioned, the reason I punted, you know, the first question to Brian is that he's done so much, you know, work in the measurement side of this, you know. So I think that it's imperative to us to really come up with solutions that you know, remove the data waste. I mean, there's so many aspects to this: scope one, scope two, scope three, but, you know, for us, we can actually do things today that actually reduce the bid requests, the multiple bid requests, and waste that occurs there that actually can have an effect today. You know, one of the big things that they talked about, though, was measurement. You know, how are we actually going to quantify the amount of carbon that we're reducing? And from what we hear in the discussions around CES, and there was a DigiDay article last week, that GARM is going to be coming out with standards, you know, for measuring. Brands really need this, because they can't be accused of greenwashing. So we have to actually come up with solutions that are bona fide measurement of the actual reduction.
How much is data the problem? Just excessive amounts of data is in creating carbon emissions. You mentioned data, so that's why I bring it up.
Well, the bid requests are, you know, Jounce Media says you've got on average 135 bid requests, which equates to, you know, publishers being connected to 27 SSPs who are connected to 20 DSPs. You know, only 25% of them provide bids. You're talking 135 bid requests times trillions of impressions.
Is that per impression? Each impression does that many bid requests.
That's correct. So
that's a lot.
So, you know, what we're focused on at Duration Media is, you know, providing opportunities to advertisers where they know that they can bid on a viewable impression that's, let's call it greener, so that, you know, we bring the bid request, you know, down to one or two or three, we can take a lot of the data waste out of the ecosystem.
Hey, Pasach, if you don't mind, I have a quick question for the smart folks on this panel real quick.
Oh, please.
Do you all feel like signal loss will reduce data wastage and, like, reduce the carbon footprint of the industry?
Reducing data waste?
Yeah, does signal loss going to help?
Signal loss, sorry.
Is signal loss going to help reduce data wastage?
Talk about, like, cookies going away or first party data?
Yeah. Like, is our cookies being deprecated? Like, if there's less kind of data to collect and capture, less data is being proliferated across the space using traditional signals like cookies and mobile device IDs. Is that going to help the data wastage problem?
I'm definitely curious how much greenhouse gases cookies produce.
So just one reaction to that, Shiv, and I don't know the answer, exactly, right? But what I can tell, and losing cookies, that to me does not have an impact, to be honest, because when the cookies will start deprecating, we will use other things. The way you offset the loss of cookies in our media operations is by more data, first party data that you are getting in. More modeling and processing and AI. So actually losing cookies will be a demand for more services, which are more sophisticated, will help us to inform better our strategies, our campaign strategy, inform better the measurement. But yeah, at the cost of having, like, more sophisticated ecosystems. So this is a little bit the equation we have to solve now, right? Is how this is being more sophisticated. How we can do it more, I mean, nimbler and better, I mean, and function better operationally. And I always back to the physical supply chain. And I mean, Brian has given that example tons of times. I'll try to make it mine for a second. Is if you think about in the 60s, the retail stores at the Walmart and the Target of the world, what those guys did is they cut the supply chain. Right? They cut many intermediaries in the chain. So for to deliver the same product to the store, you will have less intermediary, less trucks, less warehouses, less people in it. So that would be the product cheaper and faster and better quality. So that's a little bit the same we have to do here, as we have, like, more infrastructures, more offer, more types of media. I mean, today we have, like, influencers, like podcasts, we have all kind of social media anyway. You have, like, all kind of CTV, etc. So the offer we have in terms of media, like, when even 10 years ago, with most of the media was linear TV, right? So it's a big change. So as we have, like, way more, we have, like, to think about doing way in a way smarter way. I think that's where the data is coming from. And this is a little bit where I think we have to work on. I mean, in our case, in most agencies like us, but what we try to do, I simplify as much as we can our business process. Otherwise, without this, that's very difficult to have a change. And that's very difficult to change. But at the same time, this change is coming very fast because the demand is changing very fast. That's a way that's redefine your whole strategy in terms of the way the talents you hire, right? We have, like, really different type of people, the type of investment we do in technology, and also the way we interact and the way we measure success with our clients. That's been a big change in the last, I would say, in the last 5 years. So that's a little bit in a place where we are changing. I want to say we know where we go. We have an idea, but it's a little bit where we still have to be refined, and we continue tracking against this new, let's say, operating model. That's a little bit of way. It's a bit abstract, but
according to an article written in 2022, cookies produce approximately 11,000 metric tons of carbon dioxide per month. I don't know if the other ways to create signals will be any better. Because cookies are a fairly simple thing. It's a little bit of code in your browser, and it connects to it, and it says there's the cookie. I don't know if some of the other methods are any better, except maybe contextual. So who's leading the green revolution in ad tech, and who's just blowing smoke? Anyone?
That's a tough one, because I don't think there is one leader and one one person or one company leading green in ad tech. It's a combination of many players, of course, and the contribution of each one of them makes the industry get better, basically. And so that's the tricky part as well, because everybody understood that. So that's why you're seeing some companies, claiming to be green just because they're signing partnerships with others and stuff like that. Need to be careful and differentiate the right players from, I don't want to say the wrong one, but maybe. And so because it's somehow a race to the green has started, which is not the best way to proceed. But yeah, so I don't see one leader specifically, but you can see companies, and of course, Scope 3 started a lot of things in terms of just bringing the topic of sustainability within ad tech. And from there, so education started, and you got like companies, and I'm considering ourselves as part of the movement. I would not say we're leading the movement. I'm considering ourselves as part of it and trying to make things change. And around the, on that screen, on my screen, I see other companies trying to do the same thing. So, I don't know if someone disagree with me and think there is one or a few leaders, but that's the way I see it.
I heard the term collaborative competition. We're all seeing this as a real problem and developing solutions. And we're an ad tech software company. We saw 20 months ago that this was an issue, and I always say, we're thankful to Scope 3 for, creating the awareness of this, because there have been so many sectors and players. And I think the agencies have really done a great job of promoting and pushing the industry to come up with solutions. So I think that, they really need to get some credit for being, a part of the leaders in this industry. There's no doubt, a year from now, with standards and measurement, that things are going to, progress even further. And if you talk to the publishers, they'll tell you that the amount of RFIs or RFPs that they're receiving, from agencies requesting, what their green initiatives are, it's more and more, every day, every week. So I think it's been wonderful to see how, all of these disparate companies are trying to develop solutions and standards and practices, to move the industry forward.
I think so, just to add on to Ben and Andy, agree completely, and a couple more thoughts I think fit in there, right? First and foremost, tip of the hat as well to Brian for being one of the first out of the gate to drive the awareness and education. And as someone said earlier, the actual measurement, right? You can't, fix something until what the problem is. I think in our industry, a couple of categories in Scope 3 are a huge component of greenhouse gases and carbon that the industry is trying to fix. I think in addition to that, I think the question was, who's doing it right, or how do you tell? It's a different conversation with companies when they have, I'll say last person standing answering the phone to address carbon measurement, versus companies that have a dedicated product lead or a dedicated ESG lead or somebody that is a true champion, that it's either their full-time job or a big portion of their role. Educating themselves, representing the company on, events or industry boards and trying to drive change in terms of standards. and really understanding what, you know, true change is. So I think more, you know, more companies that are having dedicated leads, you know, are showing their commitment, and as well as companies that are both answering brand agency requests or just being proactive and looking at their entire corporate footprint, not just their, you know, the scope three emissions, and being transparent about it, right? And you know, admitting or sharing, you know, kind of where they are, where they come from, and where they're looking to go, and working with third parties, you know, to get, you know, independently certified on that journey as well. I think, you know, companies that have, you know, dedicated lead or team that are looking at their entire corporate footprint and are actually leaning forward in the industry are the ones that are driving the change.
I think we've almost made it clear that probably the biggest issue is the supply chain, that it is crazy. It's basically a Rube Goldberg machine on steroids. It is. We've talked about this many times before, but obviously in this context, it's not just wasting money, it's burning emissions. So what's the game plan for tidying up the digital ad supply chain? What do we need to do? Start with Brian.
Well, I mean, I think the bottom line is that the whole industry very simply follows the money. And brands and agencies really have the capability today to shift spend to higher quality supply and to shorter supply chains. It's just a matter of deciding it matters. And I think the case that it's wasteful from a planetary perspective is a very obvious one to all of us as people. This is something that's not even about like emissions. You're talking about in West London, they can't build new housing. There's a housing crisis because there's not enough electricity in that neighborhood to build houses, because that's where all of these data centers are. So to me, it's a humanitarian conversation, but let's be realistic. Like that may not resonate. So let's just talk about money. A third to half of the money that is being spent in programmatic advertising is wasted. And I think we have an obligation to remind brands, agencies, advertisers that this is something that they need to do to protect us from bad action today, but more importantly, from what's happening with AI. Generative AI is driving a huge proliferation of deepfakes, of questionable content, of brand safety risk, of manipulative content. Mm-hmm. You may have heard about a presidential election coming up in the US. You know, I do not want to hear that this was the election that AI won or lost, depending on your particular political views. And it all comes back to how does ad tech decide to spend money? And is it going to go to real quality content, however you define that? Or is it going to go get lost in some supply chains and spent in a bunch of crap inventory that we can't seem to agree on whether it's made for advertising or just pure crap? So I would resist programmatic solutions, like trying to solve technology problems with more technology. And I would focus on simple, like good advertising and responsible marketing approaches to how do we spend money effectively? And I think the signal loss question, my biggest concern with signal loss is we already can't measure. Now we're taking away the ability to do post-view, you know, attribution, which I don't think ever worked. But if you get rid of post-view and you get rid of retargeting, how does this industry tell its stories about how this crap is working? Like maybe this actually helps us get back to the basics of putting the right message on the right medium at the right moment for the right person and forgetting all this fancy tech bullshit that let us spend money willy-nilly because we were following a cookie around. I mean, if my four-year-old follows a cookie around the house, I mean, aren't we smarter than my four-year-old? Okay, I'll get off my high horse now.
So I promised myself on before this call that no matter what is said, I would not disagree with Brian on anything. But just to slightly disagree, and again, I'm surprised he said this, but I think the tech, you can't sleep on the technology solution. And I'm not speaking of anyone in particular, only because we're in the situation we're in because it was easy to do, right? You know, it's easy to buy 1,000 websites with a click of a mouse. It's easy to add 6 data partners with a click of a mouse. Brands and agencies, right, can't do hard very, very well because they don't have the bandwidth, they don't have the staff, they don't have the training, there's turnover, et cetera. So I think there is some, you know, positivity to a tech solution to make it easy for them to do the right thing. Otherwise, it's so much easier to do the wrong thing or continue doing the wrong thing. So making that data, whatever, you know, expose the data, make it measurable, build it into tools or complement tools that they're using, I think will drive things faster than, you know, just trying to be responsible. If you ask any CMO or you ask any brand person, you know, do you want to do the right thing or is this the right thing? Do you want to be, everyone will say yes and they mean it. But seven steps removed when it comes to the, you know, the campaign person setting something up, if they don't know how to do it or it's not very easy, they're just going to do what they did yesterday. And, you know, because they're already late and have to get something out the door. So, you know, I think some of the work that, you know, folks on this call and others have done to try to expose the data and create solutions and, you know, make it easier, I think is very important.
It is, but I do agree. You get like a massive portion of programmatic spend that goes to bad inventory or also called MFS sites, goes to reselling. And the challenge goes as well because, well, it's a really complex ecosystem. You agencies work, you know, create partnerships with, of course, SSPs that have the larger scale. So in order to get the larger scale, well, you resell inventory or you buy resold inventory as well. So it's an entire system that needs to be reviewed. I like the fact that sustainability accelerates all the SPO conversations, the supply path optimization conversation. And that's a good thing because it brings back something that is quite important if we want to focus on directness, optimize the supply path. And as a few of us said, it comes a lot from the media buyers, whether the brands direct or the agencies that have the power to influence the entire ecosystem to do things right. So if agencies and brands start to focus on direct path and quality inventory, would be better in terms of sustainability. But if you forget about sustainability, we should still do it no matter what. Having a shorter supply path, more direct supply path, increase performance. At the end of the day, marketers are looking to generate performance for their, with their ad campaigns. And you remove intermediates, you get better control of your media spend, you get better performance at the end of the day. So everything is tied together in a way.
Yeah, I think the focus, you know, on the supply path has really been on curating buying paths. And that's established a number of inclusion lists. So agencies have these lists. You know, our focus, and I just do disagree with Brian about the tech side, because we have created very unique tech that enables us to measure if an ad is viewable in real time. And we can we can curate a viewable green impression that can be bought either sold directly or through a viewable green PMP. I think it's a great start to curate the buying paths and to remove MFA and do a lot of those things. But I think it's, you know, it's also important to help the buyers understand the impressions that they should be buying in the sites that they want to buy. And that's really where we're focused in helping buyers go to the publishers that are in their inclusion list and supply them with the technology to enable those buyers to identify that valuable inventory.
So I just want reacting just to this. I think I'm the only one for media agency here, right? It's always kind of a chicken and egg situation where you have to evaluate what's short term and long term, right? I think Ben's explanation is very good because it's not something which is a technology or anything. It's about we change the way we do business. And we think about this is our programmatic team, for example, at Horizon, now work directly with supply side platform that it was not existing before. So that's just a way that those people are just changing the way they are performing their job every day. It means they change their performance metrics. So the way they have to be trained, the way they just like even like use their different systems. So that's kind of a long-term thing. So that has to play, and to work on this, to invest on this, it has to be, and I think, I mean, Brian said earlier, where to follow the money, right? It has to go with an incentive, a money incentive. Like doing SPO, in our case, I think at Horizon, I don't remember the business case. I mean, there is an official business case inside the company. I think it reduced our cost to 5 to 10%. So it's not a green media stuff. It's really something which is a clear business outcome, a clear quantitative business outcome. So that's one thing. This is more the long term. In the short term, it's very difficult, and that tied to long term, it's very difficult to motivate people to change the way they do business because they want to work 9 to 5. They want to deliver value for their clients like tomorrow morning, like every day. So you also have to engage your clients. And that's a way you connect the dots. If you don't engage your whole ecosystem this way, people will not change and will continue to operate the same way. Even if they attend meetings and will talk about it and find it great, like, yes, but I don't want to give up on my results if I don't have like the backup of a client or my management, right? So that's very difficult. Even if you have the technology and everything, that's why, I mean, Andy, I think I like your point is the technology also has to bring you something that you can demonstrate. Yeah, I did it 2 days this way and I will show you the result tomorrow, not in 6 months. And that's playing between that dichotomy between the long term and short term. It's very difficult because it's what actually makes you transforming your business, at least from the buying side, right? Because people are very tactical. They have to buy billions and billions of dollars every year.
So speaking of following the money, can we actually show that investing in a greener supply chain actually pays off at this point? Or do we have to wait 5 years to see the results? Anyone?
Are we talking about the results in terms of performance for marketers, or what do...
Money, as he said, we people want to follow the money. They want to make green, not just be green. Can we actually say that this is we can show results and say this is actually making the supply chain more cost efficient?
I can tell from my experience when we launched our first green media product 1.5 years ago. First, I was thinking honestly that buyers would jump on that opportunity to start spending on a greener supply path, and which wasn't the case immediately because education was really important, and the market was not really educated yet, and there is still some education to be made, of course. But in terms of what it did for us, it opened new doors in terms of business opportunities. So by helping brands and agencies spending their advertising budget in a greener way, I would call it like that, it opened new doors, we generated more business by doing that. And they saw the results from it, because by targeting those green PMPs and low emission PMPs, we were able, and we are able, to increase the performance of the campaigns because of the greener supply path as well. So, which means more direct, focusing on quality inventory, etc., etc. So it's I really see that as a win-win situation where us as a company, while we generate more revenue, we're doing the right things, or at least trying to do the right things, I would say, and advertisers get better performance at the end of the day. So answer to your questions would be yes, then.
So how are carbon conscious? Go ahead.
Yeah, I just would add something which is not as technical as Benoit said, is for us, and I mean, I think with pretty much everyone in the call here, we have this conversation. It's also, we call that the cost of doing business or license to operate. I mean, it's not only the fact that you will have a better return on that spend by having green media campaign. It's also the cost of us, for us, for an agency like us, to keep the clients and to make them happy, because our clients are asking us to have like better practices. So it's about retaining our clients, making them happier, but also acquiring new clients. And it has to be in our pitches. So again, it's a whole transformation, not only of what we do, but how we do and how we operate our business. Mm-hmm. And that's also one of the metrics which have to be included in the equation. Although, because just if you just focus on the operations itself, it has to be driven by very quantitative, objective results, which you will not see always. You will see in some cases. And the even worse is many times is the results we observe is buying less media, which is against what we do, right? So it has to show other things that we generate new revenue streams and growth with our clients in other ways.
Yeah, so our conscious campaign. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, you know, like Ben, we're driven by what clients are looking for, and you know, in addition to lowering the carbon emissions, which in some cases, you know, clients will say to us, these are the business requirements we have, and oh yeah, if I reduce carbon, yeah, that's okay, right? But you know, for us, we lower the ECPM, we increase time in view and viewability scores, we give them a higher click-through rate and actually lower the cost of their clicks while they're reducing their carbon. So, you know, these kinds of solutions, you know, are really what the clients are looking for is, you know, put aside the carbon for a second. Those are business goals or KPIs that they have that being green can actually produce.
Everyone else, have you seen that the carbon conscious campaigns actually perform better?
I can give some data. So we've run many of these. We've done, I don't know, 30, 40, 50 brand specific pilot campaigns over the past 15 months, some with agency partners, some direct with the brand. And I would say that there's probably two categories. There's brands that were already pretty green by accident. So they were tightly targeted, were optimizing well, were thoughtful about their media. And what we see is that there's not a huge change in performance. And what we're talking about, most of what we're talking about here is hygiene. We're talking about making your creative smaller. We're talking about cleaning up your supply chain and not buying a bunch of crap. But there's a shocking number of brands who just don't have good media hygiene in the first place. And there's a lot of reasons for that, which I think we all know how bad it is. If you saw the ANA transparency report that came out recently, we can say that there's, you know, data and technology and all these things, but it's 2024 and we're still having a really hard time running programmatic campaigns effectively. We can talk about all the economic reasons that's the case. So I have been shocked a couple of times by things that should work that haven't. And I think the problem is metrics. So for instance, viewability tends to be very good on a bunch of crappy sites because, mm-hmm. you know, bad actors are smart. They're like, I have 42 ads that you can look at. And that's one of my concerns is when we say, well, I made it perform better because I drove clicks or I drove views. At the end of the day, ROAS is what matters. And what matters when you buy Facebook, you get a 5x return on ad spend. You buy YouTube, you get a 5x return on ad spend. You go buy a bunch of programmatic and you get a negative return on ad spend. And honestly, it doesn't really matter why. If you're a CMO, you're just like, I'm not doing it. I'm pulling my spend. The number of big brands we've talked to who don't buy programmatic is terrifying if you're in this programmatic industry. Or it's incredibly exciting if you realize how much dry powder marketers have to go reinvest in the open web, we could just clean it up. And so I think what I've been seeing over the past year is both a mix of horror at how bad this is in some cases and deep optimism that there's a better future out there. It's a greener future. It's a more transparent future. It's a more privacy-centric future. But the reality is if it's not a more performant future, we ain't getting there. And so I think that to me is the most important thing we come back to at Scope 3 is we have to be granular with our measures so that we can find those opportunities. If we just have a single average, there's folks out there like, I'm going to give you a single carbon impact score for your whole company. Well, how the heck do you optimize that? You know, we know that if you're on Snap and you use the fancy, you know, sponsored lens where you get cat ears, there's a dramatically different carbon footprint than if you're streaming a 67 video. And we need to know that as marketers. What is the difference of skippable and non-skippable on YouTube? I have to know that because that has a big financial impact, has a big carbon impact, and has a big performance impact. That's the kind of conversation we have to have if we're going to solve the problem
which I'm calling a carbon problem, but it's really a performance and an outcomes problem. And when you see things like PMax and Google's deploying, you know, the world's best AI to drive marketing outcomes, it's because they don't think that people using all their tools to target are as good as their AIs at driving performance, because they know performance drives spend. So anything we talk about here is we have to make the open web more performant so we can get more money. And the only way to do that is to reduce waste and stop doing all these crazy things, which we're calling a sustainability problem in the environmental context, but it's also a sustainability problem in the sense of, does this industry exist in 5 or 10 years, or is it overrun by people who don't get stuck in all of these sort of hacky ways of solving these problems and just say, let my AI do it for you? Because that's where the market's going, other than all of us, you know, old school ad tech dinosaurs. So, and I totally agree, David, that, and Andy, like, I get, as an ad tech person, like, me saying technology can't solve these problems is, you know, somewhat hypocritical and kind of terrifying. Yeah. But I also think that we get stuck in the idea that if there's just one more button or one more data or one more cool ad format, that would make it all work. And I just worry that that's an arms race with the biggest technology companies in the world. Amazon has a larger R&D budget than France. I mean, all of the companies in France. And we can't compete in an arms race with these companies. We have to compete on things that we can actually control. And we can control how we actually show up and the stories we tell and how we educate and how we actually change the way we all operate, because we are some of the most influential people in this industry, or we wouldn't be on this podcast. How do we use our influence to make a better outcome, not just for us, but for the billions of people who use the internet every day and don't want it to be a big tech AI controlled internet? I'll put myself in that camp. I think that's the opportunity, and it's the risk if we fail.
That raises a good question. How do we embed sustainability into people's core, into a company's core values beyond just a PR stuff? Is it just more of these discussions?
No, I think, you know, what I mentioned earlier about having like a dedicated, educated, you know, responsible person that looks at, you know, sustainability or ESG, whether it's, you know, in the media campaign space or the entire corporate, you know, space. I think from a leadership executive standpoint, again, both in and out of the digital industry, providing incentives, bonuses, you know, compensation around, you know, reductions and savings and efficiencies, you know, I think is a possible or one way of motivating or holding folks accountable. As well. And, you know, we've said it, I think each one of us has said it, the education, right? Continuing the education, you know, the standards, the evangelizing the benefits, you know, of doing the right thing or measuring the right output to be able to get your results in the ROAS that Brian mentioned. I think continuing down that path, you know, will help move, you know, the needle more and more each day.
On our end, sustainability is part of our company OKRs, and the reason we include it, and we don't have like tons of OKRs, like we have 3 main OKRs, so which shows that it's a real priority. And the reason why we did that is also to include our employees in the process. Yes, you could have like a chief sustainability officer, which makes you look good on LinkedIn, you know, and from a PR standpoint. And it's important for large organizations. We're not a large organization, so there is a difference there. But really for us, educating our employees so they understand what we mean by ESG and sustainability and really what's the difference between scope 1, 2, and 3 emissions, where do our emissions come from? You know, if they understand that, oh wow, travel represents a large portion of our company's emission, well, let's be part of the solution to decrease, to reduce those emissions together. And you know what? Employees, they have great, great ideas. And having them part of the process really makes a big difference in what we can accomplish as a business. So that's a bit what we're doing at the company level on our end. And of course, we are measuring our emissions in order to be able to do that. So yeah, that's it.
Yeah, I agree on the measuring emissions part. I actually just got our 2022 greenhouse gas emissions inventory report. And I think, you know, we should all be leading that, especially from this side of the equation, is that if you're measuring or if you're a tech company providing solutions, I think it's important to show your commitment to, you know, measuring greenhouse emissions. And if you're not doing it, I encourage that you should do it. I know, being a multinational supporter of Net Zero, you know, they're requiring folks that are supporting to be in that position. And I think it's just part of the leadership role here that we have to help move the industry into what I really think is the important part, is the standards and practices and measurement. You know, we look at this as like the early days of viewability, when we would create solutions, but we couldn't grade our own homework. And then Moat and IAS Double Verify became, you know, bona fide measurement companies. And I think that when GARM comes out with the standards, you'll see a lot more folks being comfortable as to how this all works for everybody.
Why is the entire eco-conscious ad tech push more popular in Europe than in here? Is there a specific reason that Americans seem to be more just not interested?
I think some of it is culture and some of it is legislation. You know, there's been more aggressive, you know, legislation or advanced legislation overseas than you know, in the U.S. around, you know, carbon measurement or accountability. And I, you know, I think it's, you know, U.S. is catching up, but I think it's just been more time and more, you know, requirements around it put on, you know, companies, that it's more top of mind or higher priority.
Is legislation the key for this to take off?
I think it's one of them.
I mean, I think, just on Mark here, I mean, I think it helps a lot. I mean, European Union has had Europe-level legislation in place for like about 20 years or more, right? I remember being like a still like consultant or big consulting firm in Europe, like working on, environmental compliance at the end of the 2000s, right? So that's something we were already working with, like different chemical industries in Germany or even like power plants and stuff. So that was something that you had to start working. So those companies had started working on being compliant, reducing their emissions and being more transparent. And I think my opinion, and it's like very something open to discussion, is it created a culture of traceability on the product. Today, who in the US, which consumers is looking at the ingredients in the product you buy? A few of us, right? A few of us, but not that many, right? And probably because you prefer not to know what's in it, right? Maybe that's a reason why. I'm a bit sarcastic here. But in by those regulation at the end of 2000, that's something which came up way more in France or in Spain or in Portugal, Germany, etc. Because you say, hey, that product contains palm oil. So it's not a good product. People don't know why, but it's just they have seen it everywhere in the magazines and on TV and everything. And even sometimes it has to be advertised on the sticker of the product you buy. Here it does not exist, right? So this is also something that culturally came, and it's coming right now in the US to have like that traceability in the product, that the visibility of the traceability. That's one of my perception, my own experience, right?
What's the yardstick of success? How do we know if a company is successful becoming eco-conscious? How do we measure success?
So you mean like our media companies or our clients?
In general, I mean, so what is the standard of successful, truly eco-conscious campaign?
If we talk about a campaign specifically, it's a complex question because I don't think there is one simple answer to that. I think you need to distinguish the different elements from your campaigns. If we talk simply on really focus on the sustainability aspect of the campaign, and ask yourself, did you do everything you could do to reduce emissions on that campaign, you know, first. So look at the supply path, as we discussed. Look at your creative process. Do you have the right creative process in place that allows to minimize emissions on the creative side? Do you have the right optimization during the campaign that allows to not only target inventory because it's a low emission inventory, but continuing during the campaign delivery to reduce those emissions and really test and see, are you able to maintain the same level of performance while reducing emissions? But I think the key focus should remain on reduction efforts. And you'll see sometimes you're able to reduce drastically emissions, but you're also reducing performance then. So once again, finding the right balance and making progress campaign after campaign is what I would suggest.
You know, Martin Bryan, who's the head of global sustainability head at IPG, I love stealing his line. It's to me, the success would be purpose and profit. So that you do reduce your carbon while you're meeting your marketing goals, or I think, you know, those two words really, really, really say it all.
Is that the key message to give to your potential clients or advertisers, is that there is a profit in sustainability? Is that something that has to be talked about continually?
I don't think there needs to be a cost to it. You know, we focus on developing a publisher centric product that can be offered to buyers for a number of reasons. Our core technology has been on 500 publishers globally, you know, for, you know, the 5 years that we've been in business. But the supply path issue or the as.txt issue for publishers has made them angry. You know, just because I have too many lines of as.txt doesn't mean I'm a bad actor. I may optimize, I may go down to 2 or 3 or 5, you know, certain times of the day. You know, so a lot of the publishers have been thinking that I don't want to reduce my as.txt because I want the bid pressure. But I think, you know, that solutions like we have, and I'm sure there'll be others, can help publishers figure out how they can actually reduce their carbon and be profitable. So I think that's the key. I mean, there's so many variables here and so many different players, but I think that's how publishers are looking at it.
A year from now, we come back to do this again, what do you think the changes will be made in a year? Do you think consumers will get on board? Anyone?
Consumers are already on board. Mm-hmm. We mentioned earlier, like 85%, I think that's the number we said earlier, right? Of consumers under 35 years old are looking for brands to be sustainable. Mm-hmm. So actually the question we have actually for many of our clients is, how we reach those customers to show that our product is sustainable. And actually we have also like helping, like driving campaigns on more sustainable products in our client portfolio. And there is a shift, progressively shift, right? And that changed a little bit our industry, because we are not media buyers and pushing, you know, commercial like to different channels. We're also advisors. So consumers are on board. Employees are on board as well. Employees want, especially younger talent, that the one normally you are chasing, right? Is looking for purpose-driven organizations. I'm pretty sure Brian received a ton of resumes more than us, right? Being a younger company. So that's a big, big deal as well, right? So between consumers, between employees, but also investors, right? Investors have to report, to Wall Street. They have to consume, let's say, ESG reports. So you have the money, you have the employees, you have the clients. So there's just a movement that you can stop, and it goes like all together. So definitely in a year from now, my opinion, things will have changed drastically. And it's probably nothing compared to the year after and the year after and the year after. It's just a movement, my opinion.
I think if you add the measurement part, you know, that's coming, I think that's going to push things forward tremendously.
Yeah, I think the we're still lacking some industry standards when it comes to measurement. We're in an industry where we like, and it's really important to have some kind of industry standards. And so not every companies are doing their own things, and so to avoid having like many different ways of measuring, for example, and a year from now, I hope the industry will have made a drastic progress in setting up some standards, so the industry can really follow that and make even more progress at reducing emissions.
Hey, before we go, if you could send yourself a text message to 2004, what would you tell yourself? Start with Shiv.
1 year back.
Party more?
and that's related to sustainability how?
I mean, you broadly asked the question. So I just, you know, that's what I would text myself to the 2004 version of me. Yeah, that's all I got.
Brian?
Sell Yahoo stock right after Microsoft makes the $33 a share offer. Don't wait till it goes to $7.
Yeah, I tell this all the time. In 1995, when Bill Gates' book came out, I told myself I should have bought stock. And of course, now it's split like 6 times since then, so I should have bought stock then too. David, what would you tell yourself?
Brian beat me to it. I was going to say just buy Apple and Amazon or, you know, something along those lines back then. Tell myself, I don't know, maybe invent an automatic way to buy advertising at scale across thousands of sites and turn it into a whole ecosystem that can then critique for the next 20 years.
But, isn't that that's what Brian did? It. Brian was called Right Media. I remember this.
He emailed himself. Text word around.
I wrote it. He sent it to me by accident. I got this weird message from the future from some dude named David, and I'm like, great idea, future David. So thank you.
If only they delivered that book that says all the sports scores for the last 50 years that you could bet on and fly back in time.
I'll take the ad tech tip, actually. I think it worked out fine.
If I bring back the answer, and I'm the boring one, bringing back the answer related to sustainability, I would say start raising awareness way earlier. That's what I would probably do. We would not be in the same position today.
Jean-Marc.
Yeah, I think Ben stole my ideas, and it's really, I think it's more about start working on it now, because you can make an impact, right? And it can be small things, it can be big things, and yeah, don't believe you can do anything for this to prevent global warming and to make the world a better place to live in general.
Yeah, I would have told myself to go green earlier because my kids now think I'm cool.
Jobs in AdTech.
Are you looking for a new role in the industry? Head over to jobsinadtech.com today. Employers attract top talent for as little as £50 per open job role.
And that's all, folks. Thank you for listening. And please subscribe to our podcast on your favorite platform or YouTube.